Hey, welcome to a study of Esther for such a time as this. This is Dan Williams, and I'm going to be teaching this through the month of February 2024 at Lexington Baptist Church. And so I hope you can stay with me for all four of these sessions. I'm putting them on YouTube, obviously. And so here we go. Let's get into this wonderful story, prophetic as well as historic. First you got to know the main characters in this story, and there are five main characters. You have, of course, Esther, and you have her uncle Mordecai. You have King Ahasuerus, also known as Xerxes, and then Queen Vashti, who has a brief role in this story. And then the villain of the story, Haman, or Haman. It's these five are the main characters. Let's look a little bit closer at each one of these. Esther was not her real name. She was born Hadassah. Hadassah is a Jewish name, a Hebrew name that comes from the word hadas, which means myrtle tree. The myrtle tree is a symbol of love, peace, and abundance in Jewish tradition. It's often used in religious ceremonies and festivals. But Hadassah was born in captivity in the Babylonian exile. As you recall, 586 BC, the southern kingdom of Judah was overrun by the Babylonians under Nebuchadnezzar, and many of the Jews from the tribe of Judah and Benjamin were taken into exile. The northern kingdom was called Israel. It had already been conquered by the Assyrians, as if you know your Jewish history. So she was born into captivity as a daughter of a Jewish parents who died and left her as an orphan. And that is why Mordecai came into the picture. He was a descendant of Saul and the great-grandson of Kish, who taken in the Babylonian exile under Nebuchadnezzar. He was of the tribe of Benjamin. He adopted Hadassah and raised her as his own daughter. He was a courageous man of deep convictions about the God of Abraham and his hand upon the Jewish people. His Hebrew name was Petachiah. Petach means to open. Petachiah, Yah, short for Yahweh, Yahweh. So that means God opens. He was the first in the Bible to be called a Jew. As you know, there are 12 sons of Jacob and the 12 tribes. And Judah was just one of the tribes. But when the kingdom divided and 10 of the tribes went with the northern kingdom, Assyria came and overran them and took them into captivity, assimilated them into their culture, ended up in Europe. And guess what? They ended up here in America, the tribes of Ephraim and Manasseh particularly. But in the southern kingdom, there was left the kingdom, the tribe of Judah and Benjamin, and some Levites who were keepers of the temple. And somehow or another, the tribe of Judah, which was the largest tribe, just kind of became a catch-all word for any person of Hebrew descent. They were all called Juden, from Judah, and it was just shortened to Jew. And so Mordecai, who was a Benjamite, he was in the southern kingdom, the tribe of Benjamin, but he is the first that the Bible will use that catch-all word, Jew. And then there's King Ahasuerus, given as the name of King of Persia in the book of Ezra. The Persian Empire, at its height, was huge, 2 million square miles. It really was. It encompassed most all the Middle East, Asia Minor, modern-day Turkey, the Holy Land, Iran, Iraq, all the way to India and Ethiopia, as not mentioned here, all the way into Africa. Modern commentators associate him with Xerxes I, who reigned from 486 to 465 BC in the Greek Septuagint, and he's called Artaxerxes. Historian Herodotus describes Xerxes I as being susceptible to women and in the habit of making extravagant offers to them. You'll see that in the story, just as he did to Esther, where he offered up to half my kingdom, seemingly on a whim. Then there's Queen Vashti, the king's queen. Not much is known of Vashti from the biblical account than her refusal to be made a spectacle by her lecherous husband. Other Jewish sources say that Vashti had royal blood. According to one account, Vashti was the daughter of Belshazzar, wow, the king of Babylon. She was just a child the night her father died from a bizarre accident. A candelabrum fell on him during a dinner party and crushed his skull. The palace was in an uproar after the disaster, and young Vashti, not realizing Belshazzar was dead, scurried amongst the traumatized dinner guests in search of her father's comfort when she mistakenly sat in the lap of Darius. He took pity on the beautiful young girl and betrothed her to his son, Ahasuerus. So that is some of the, from other sources than the Bible, some possible history there for Vashti. And the villain of the story. Then there is the antagonist, a wicked man named Haman. Haman is first mentioned in Esther 3:1, where it says, after these things, King Ahasuerus promoted Haman the Agagite, the son of Hammedatha, and advanced him and set his throne above all the officials who were with him. Haman had become one of King Xerxes' chief advisors, but power went to his head. He was proud and arrogant. He demanded respect. He also was part of a plot to poison the king. He eventually was hanged for treason on a gallows that he actually had built and intended for his nemesis, Mordecai. So all the plot thickens as we see these characters and the parts that they play. The Agagite, he was of the descendants of Agag, who was an evil enemy of the children of Israel. So where did this story take place geographically? Let's first start with that. And I've got a little short video here that I'll show you that helps give us the answer for that.
In modern-day Iran lies the ancient city of Shushan, known as Susa in English renderings of the Bible. Susa is the site of the famous story of Queen Esther. Its palace was also home to biblical Nehemiah and was envisioned by the prophet Daniel. Excavated for almost 100 years, the site of Susa has revealed her ruined Persian palace and royal city, showing students of the Bible that the Book of Esther must retain eyewitness reports of its function and layout. Today, some of the decorative palace remains are stored in the Louvre, including a foundation inscription that records where all the luxury building materials were brought from. The royal palace of Susa was built by Esther's father-in-law, Darius I, known to history as King Darius the Great. Darius constructed Susa as a winter capital of the Persian Empire. Here, he constructed a massive 12-acre terrace, upon which he built his monumental palace connected to the city of Susa by a large gate known in Esther as the King's Gate. To access the palace compound, one would have to cross a bridge over a river and walk through the King's Gate into a large courtyard outside of the palace. This system of the palace complex being separated from the city proper is reflected in the Book of Esther that distinguishes between the city of Susa and the citadel of Susa that should be identified as the palace complex. Inside the palace, the royal banquet hall has been identified. It was a pillared room whose elaborately decorated columns were 65 feet tall. This banquet hall saw the infamous Feast of Xerxes when he drunkenly requested Queen Vashti's presence. It was also a main place of Nehemiah's work as cupbearer to King Artaxerxes. The very spot of the king's throne in this banquet hall has been identified by its stone base centered between the pillars of the room. The palace itself was organized in a more Babylonian style, incorporating three main courtyards that created a grand walkway through the palace on the way to the king's throne room. These courtyards would have been decorated with stone reliefs and glazed bricks, and they were separated by guardhouses. The Book of Esther indicates that the outer courtyard was the place that royal officials would come with their business and wait to be summoned by the king, as Haman providentially did. From the layout of the palace, it's easy to see that the king's throne, located in his great hall or throne room, would have had a direct line of sight to the inner courtyard, where Esther is said to have illegally come to request an audience with her husband. Esther herself would have come from the women's quarters, through the palace's middle courtyard, and into the inner courtyard, a route that can still be walked by modern visitors to Susa.
Gives us a good explanation of where Susa or Shushan is in modern day Iran. So let's jump into the story. Esther chapter 1. Now in the days of Ahasuerus, who reigned from India to Ethiopia over 127 provinces, in those days when King Ahasuerus sat on his royal throne in Susa, the citadel, in the third year of his reign, he gave a feast for all of his officials and servants, the army of Persia and Media, and the nobles and governors. The provinces were before him, while he showed the riches of his royal glory and the splendor and pomp of his greatness for many days, 180 days. And when these days were completed, the king gave for all the people present in Susa, the citadel, both great and small, a feast lasting 7 days in the court of the garden of the king's palace. There were white cotton curtains and violet hangings, fastened with cords of fine linen and purple to silver rods and marble pillars, and also couches of gold and silver on a mosaic pavement of porphyry, marble, mother of pearl, and precious stones. Can you imagine? Drinks were served in golden vessels of different kinds, and the royal wine was lavished according to the bounty of the king. And drinking was according to this edict. There is no compulsion, for the king had given orders to all the staff of his palace to do as each man desired. Drink as much as you want. Do what you want. If it feels good, do it. Queen Vashti also gave a feast for the women in the palace that belonged to King Ahasuerus. And so he was definitely a worldly man with great appetites. On the seventh day, when the heart of the king was merry with wine, he commanded 7 eunuchs who served in the presence of King Ahasuerus, commanded them to bring Queen Vashti before the king with her royal crown in order to show the peoples and the princes her beauty, for she was lovely to look at. But Queen Vashti refused to come at the king's command delivered by the eunuchs. At this, the king became enraged, and his anger burned within him. He was very egotistical, and he had many women. He was not faithful or loyal to any one woman. I love the artist's drawing of Queen Vashti here. Look at the expression on her face. Now, I just imagine her saying something according to that look like this. Seriously? He wants to parade me around like his trophy. Why don't I just pop out of the cake? No way, Jose. Well, that infuriated the king. Then the king said to the wise men who knew the times, for this was the king's procedure toward all who were versed in law and judgment. According to the law, what is to be done to Queen Vashti because she has not performed the command of King Ahasuerus delivered by the eunuchs? Well, it turns out that she was dethroned being queen, but most likely from other historical sources and writings, she was put to death. Then Memucan said in the presence of the king and the officials, not only against the king has Queen Vashti done wrong, but also against all the officials and all the peoples who are in all the provinces of King Ahasuerus. See, this is a very male-dominated society here. And they said the queen's behavior will be made known to all women, causing them to look at their husbands with contempt, since they will say, well, King Ahasuerus commanded Queen Vashti to be brought before him, and she didn't come. So these men were very much afraid that this was going to be a norm. This very day, the noble women of Persia and Media who have heard of the queen's behavior will say the same to all the king's officials, and there'll be contempt and wrath in plenty. How many times in history have there been knee-jerk reactions made against hypothetical situations that probably never would have happened? If it please the king, let a royal order go out from him that Vashti is never again to come before King Ahasuerus, and let the king give her royal position to another who is better than she. So when the decree was made by the king is proclaimed throughout all his kingdom, all women will give honor to their husbands, high and low alike. This advice pleased the king, and he sent letters to all the royal provinces, that every man be master in his own household and speak according to the language of his people, because there are a lot of different languages and dialects throughout this Persian empire. After all these things, when the anger of the king Ahasuerus had abated, he remembered Vashti and what she had done and what had been decreed against her. Then the king's young men who attended him said, "Let beautiful young virgins be sought out for the king, and let the king appoint officers in all the provinces of his kingdom to gather all the beautiful young virgins to the harem in Susa, the citadel, under custody of Hegai, the king's eunuch, who is in charge of the women. Let their cosmetics be given them." Isn't that interesting? Looking at this ancient text talking about cosmetics. I wonder what those cosmetics included. You can just only imagine things to enhance the eyes, the lips, creation of lipstick. Would be something good for a historian to look into if they could identify what cosmetics they were talking about. But they said, "And let the young woman who pleases the king, the young woman who pleases the king, be queen instead of Vashti." And this pleased the egotistical king, and he did so. This is when Mordecai comes into the picture. Now there was a Jew. You see, he's described as a Jew. He was a Benjamite, but already here the catch-all phrase Jew for any of the Hebrew. There was a Jew in Susa, the citadel, whose name was Mordecai, a Benjamite, who had been carried away from Jerusalem among the captives, carried away when Jeconiah, king of Judah, whom Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, had carried away. He was bringing up Hadassah, that is, Esther, the daughter of his uncle, for she had neither father nor mother. The young woman had a beautiful figure and was lovely to look at, and when her father and her mother died, Mordecai took her as his own daughter. And you see here, this is where she's identified as Hadassah and Esther. And so her Jewishness from the get-go, as far as the king was concerned, was hidden that she even was Jewish. So when the king's order and his edict were proclaimed, and when many young women were gathered in Susa, the citadel in custody of Hegai, Esther also was taken into the king's palace and put in custody of Hegai, who had charge of the women, and the young woman who pleased him and won his favor. And he quickly provided her with her cosmetics and her portion of food and with 7 chosen young women from the king's palace. It's kind of like this beauty pageant, and these were the finalists, you might say, and advanced her and her young women to the best place in the harem. Esther had not made known her people or kindred, for Mordecai had commanded her not to make it known. And every day Mordecai walked in front of the court of the harem to learn how Esther was and what was happening to her. Now when the turn came for each young woman to go into King Ahasuerus, after being 12 months, that's a year, under the regulations for the women, since this was the regular period of their beautifying, 6 months with oil of myrrh and 6 months with spices and ointments for women. When the young woman went into the king in this way, she was given whatever she desired to take with her from the harem to the king's palace. And that's interesting. What would they have desired to take with them? Perhaps it was, you would think it's something that would make them more attractive, that would, because perhaps these women really wanted to be selected. As we learn later, Esther didn't take anything with her. She really didn't want to be selected. She had already been, she was raised in the faith of Yahweh and the Torah, and she was already being forced into a lot of worldliness. And so I think she was very reluctant to participate in all this, certainly. And here it says, in the evening she would go in, and in the morning she would return to the second harem in custody of Shaashgaz, the king's eunuch, who was in charge of the concubines. Well, you see, wow, doesn't quite come out and say it, but these women had sex with the king. That was part of their audition. They went in the evening and they would come out the next morning. They weren't having a stay up all night card game. And it uses the word charge of the concubines. And so we know what's considered as a concubine. So it, like, the Bible doesn't come right out and say that the king had sex with these women, but is certainly implied. And with his godless character, the pagan king that he was, no doubt this is exactly what happened. It says she would not go in to the king again unless the king delighted in her and she was summoned by name. So the story continues. When the turn came for Esther to go in to the king, she asked for nothing except what Haggai, the king's eunuch, who had charge of the women, advised. Now Esther was winning favor in the eyes of all who saw her, and when Esther was taken to King Ahasuerus into his royal palace, the king loved Esther more than all the women. From just reading the surface of this, you could take it that just her beauty alone is what grabbed his attention. And she won grace and favor in his sight more than all the virgins, so that he set the royal crown on her head and made her queen instead of Vashti. It's like the beauty pageant was over. She won. Then the king gave a great feast for all his officials and servants. It was Esther's feast. He also granted a remission of taxes to the provinces and gave gifts with royal generosity. So King Ahasuerus was completely overjoyed and satisfied that he had found his new queen. Now when the virgins were gathered together the second time, Mordecai was sitting at the king's gate. Esther had not made known her kindred or her people as Mordecai had commanded her, for Esther obeyed Mordecai just as when she was brought up by him. In those days, as Mordecai was sitting at the king's gate, Bigtan and Teresh, two of the king's eunuchs who guarded the threshold, became angry and sought to lay hands on King Ahasuerus. Don't know what they were angry about, but obviously the king was not extremely popular with everybody. And this came to the knowledge of Mordecai, and he told it to Queen Esther. And Esther told the king in the name of Mordecai. When the affair was investigated and found to be so, the men were both hanged on the gallows, and it was recorded in the book of the Chronicles in the presence of the king. After these things, King Ahasuerus promoted Haman the Agagite and advanced him and set his throne above all the officials who were with him. And all the king's servants who were at the king's gate bowed down and paid homage to Haman, for the king had so commanded concerning him. But Mordecai did not bow down or pay homage. Then the king's servants who were at the king's gate said to Mordecai, "Why do you transgress the king's command? And when they spoke to him day after day and he would not listen to them, they told Haman in order to see whether Mordecai's words would stand, for he had told them he was a Jew. And when Haman saw that Mordecai did not bow down or pay homage to him, Haman was filled with fury, but he disdained to lay hands on Mordecai alone. So as they had made known to him the people of Mordecai, Haman sought to destroy all the Jews, the people of Mordecai, throughout the whole kingdom of Ahasuerus. Wow, he wanted to commit genocide of all the Jewish people, which would primarily be those of Judah and Benjamin and Levi, all those that were considered Jewish. Okay, I'm going to stop right here in the story of Esther. There's so much more that we couldn't cover today, but you've got the basic plot has been laid out and the characters involved in this story. But I wanted to take end up this session speaking a little bit about Purim. This is the feast of celebration by the Jewish people ever since this event happened, where they celebrated this, basically the rescue, the salvation of the Jewish people from annihilation, from Haman's plan to have them all destroyed. And I guess it'd be much like, you know, we celebrate the victory of 1776 and, you know, 4th of July or Armistice Day. This is a feast, a joyful celebration. And let me tell you a little bit about this feast. It's called a feast. It's just a celebration. It's a jolly Jewish holiday of Purim. It's celebrated every year on the 14th of the Hebrew month of Adar, which is like the 12th month of the calendar. It comes in late winter, early spring. Purim 2024 is going to begin on Saturday night, March 23rd, and continues through Sunday, March 24th, you know, a day beginning in the evening. So the evening of March 23rd through the evening of March 24th. It commemorates the salvation of the Jewish people in the ancient Persian Empire from Haman's plot to destroy, kill, and annihilate all the Jews in a single day. Purim literally means lots. You know, when you add im on the end of a Jewish word, that's like adding the S. Pur means that chance, to the lot. So Purim is like lots, casting lots in ancient Persian. Purim was thus named since Haman had thrown lots to determine when he would carry out his diabolical scheme. The entire story of Esther could be punctuated with the phrase throughout the narrative, and it just so happened that Mordecai overheard these two guys. It just so happened that Esther found favor in the king. It just so happened that Haman came. So the whole story, it goes like that. And there's no mention of God in the book of Esther. Yet it is so obvious that that God is orchestrating and controlling the events that take place. It teaches us that God is always working in the background, even when we're not aware. And that's exactly what goes on in this story of Esther. It's also interesting to note that some specific deliverances of God for his people Israel have happened on a feast of Purim in history, such as in the early 1950s, Joseph Stalin, the ruthless butcher of millions of innocent people, had bloody plans for dealing with the Jewish problem in Russia and USSR. Just as things were reaching a crisis point in 1953, Stalin died on Purim. 1990, remember Saddam Hussein of Iraq defiantly invaded Kuwait. As pressure ramped up from the international community, his army began firing Scud missiles into Israel. Rabbi Schneerson repeatedly assured the people of Israel that they would be protected. And after U.S.-led forces attacked Iraq, they were quickly victorious and the hostilities ended on Purim. So it is it's an important day amongst Jewish people to celebrate. And I'm going to leave you this time with a song that's going to be our theme song for this study, and it's the Maranatha Praise Band song called For Such a Time as This. I remember singing this song with the Maranatha Praise Band at Promise Keepers back in the early 2000s. I think the song was written about 1999. But we're going to see throughout this study as we get into it the correlation. Why are we studying this today? What is the such a time as this that we're living in? And who might the Father be calling out to stand up with the courage of Mordecai and Esther? All right, till then, we'll see you later.
Such a time.